How many people here either have been or are smokers or nicotine consumers? Oh, wow. who isn't and never has been? You are weird. You are like super weird. You're like super weird people.
It's the younger people.
The younger people.
Yeah, yeah. Bless. They're innocent of this.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's kind of interesting. And I mean, what I love about Gregor's essay, and I wrote an introduction for it that was in The Guardian a couple of weeks ago as well, and that what I loved about it was like, people don't really talk about nicotine in the way that I want to talk about it. But Gregor's essay does talk about it in that way. And I think that there's a kind of, the discourse about nicotine is very, very strange and polarized in our culture. So in a sense, we're going to use nicotine as a prism to discuss other things, whether it be, the nature of writing, the creative act, drugs in general, cultural customs. We're going to kind of, so it's not just going to be like, thanks. It's going to be more to it than that. And I'm hoping that people are going to kind of contribute their own experience, their own attitudes, their own feelings, their own experience. I like to view this as not a conventional literary event, but more of a kind of extended group therapy session on our issues, which are manifold. But over to you, Gregor, for a reading from the text.
Okay. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for this, for being here. Well, it's wonderful to have as an interlocutor such a committed smoker. I know you don't like that word. I'm just going to read a short passage from the beginning of the book, just so you get a feel for it. I already apologize for stumbling through this English text. It's not, I've never read this in public because it's not my, it's the translator's text. I've smoked well over 100,000 cigarettes in my life, and each one of those cigarettes meant something to me. I even enjoyed a few of them. I've smoked okay, great, and terrible cigarettes. I've smoked dry and moist, aromatic and almost sweet cigarettes. I've smoked hastily and other times slowly and with pleasure. I've scrounged, stolen, and smuggled cigarettes. I've obtained them by devious means and I've begged for them. I once paid $13 for a pack at a New York airport. This is now the normal price. But when I wrote this, it was $5 a pack, I think. I've thrown out half-full packs only to fish them back out of the rubbish to render them useless once and for all under the tap. I've smoked cold cigarette butts, cigars, cigarillos, bidis, Kretex, spliffs, and straw. I've missed flights because of cigarettes and burned holes in trousers and car seats. I've singed my eyelashes and eyebrows, fallen asleep while smoking, and dreamt of cigarettes, of relapses and flames and bitter withdrawal. I've smoked in over 45 degree heat and in minus 25 cold, in libraries and seminar rooms, on ships and mountaintops, on the steps of Aztec pyramids, furtively in an old observatory, in basements and barns and beds and swimming pools, on air mattresses and in thin-hulled rubber dinghies, on the prime meridian in Greenwich and the 180th meridian in Fiji. I've smoked because I was full, and I've smoked because I was hungry. I've smoked because I was glad, and I've smoked because I was depressed. I've smoked out of loneliness and out of friendship, out of fear and out of exuberance. Every cigarette that I've ever smoked served a purpose. They were a signal, medication, a stimulant, or a sedative. They were a plaything, an accessory, a fetish object, something to help pass the time, a memory aid, communication tool, or an object of meditation. Sometimes they were all of those things at once. I no longer smoke, but there are still moments when I can think of nothing but cigarettes. This is one of those moments. I really shouldn't be writing this book. It's much too risky. But I won't be deterred. I will write about it all without mystifying or demonizing it. I regret nothing. Every cigarette I've ever smoked was a good cigarette. There are people I'd really like to smoke a cigarette with. Friends I haven't seen for a long time. Artists I admire. Will. That this won't come to pass isn't solely down to me and my resolution. Most of them don't smoke anymore. Some of them are dead. I would have liked to have smoked with my grandfather, whose huge calloused hands always made the cigarette look so thin and fragile. He died too soon. I'm convinced that he died because his cigarettes were taken away from him when he was admitted to hospital after a fall, even if he only smoked 5 or 10 a day for 60 years. I often dreamt of smoking in an art museum. I imagined how I would sit in one of those smooth, solid wood benches already warmed by the obliquely angled afternoon sun in front of a quickly painted and austere group portrait by Franz Hals, for instance, and light up a Finas, a filterless Oriental cigarette that sadly vanished from the market a few years ago. I have no doubt that this would be a moment of absolute clarity, perhaps my greatest moment of happiness. This will never happen. I no longer smoke, but I can write about it. And as I circle the subject of my addiction, a central theme in my life, through writing, I might as well ask myself a few questions. How did I become a smoker? What was it that I needed? Did the countless cigarettes I smoked throughout the course of my life satisfy this need? How did I deal with my addiction alongside the occasional fear of not being able to control it? Was I not afraid of the risks? There's no need for me to set out my reasons for quitting. Everyone knows the arguments, the social and the medical. Smoking is a compulsive behavior. He who conquers his urges gains his freedom. I failed often enough to know that I'm right at the beginning. I've decided that this time I'll write my way out of my addiction by telling its story. I'm devoting my undivided attention to a structure that governed nearly my entire life, and that at times I actually mistook for being life. I took many of my patterns of behavior, automatisms, and thought processes for granted. I never even noticed them. It's only now, in retrospect, that I can engage with them and begin to make sense of them. Something staggering occurs to me. I've smoked well over 100,000 cigarettes, and with the best of intentions, cannot say whether the paper crackles when you light one, like in the old cinema adverts. I've never noticed, not once. Thank you. I've noticed that when I wrote this, that you know I've smoked well over 100,000 cigarettes in my life. That's actually not very much, but at the time I wrote this, I just thought it sounded good and it sounded like a lot of cigarettes. But if you calculate it, it's more like 500,000, and so I mean I don't need to compete, you know. It's okay if it's just 100,000, but it has occurred to me that this is actually not very much. You've probably smoked much, much, much more than that.
I don't know. I do know that the doctor I saw the other day told me how to calculate smoking years.
Yeah.
And I had 41.
Huh.
So, you know.
How do you calculate that?
He burst out laughing when I told him I had 41 smoking years, because I don't think he'd ever met anybody with that smoking years. Just on the final point of information, whether they crackle or not when you light them, it's a difficult proposition, isn't it? I mean, one of the things, I was in an editing suite working where they were editing a film, a big new digital suite, and they were doing the Foley, which is the name for, you know, redubbing the sound onto a film. And the thing that they were doing was lighting a cigarette, and they massively Foley'd it. It sounded, And when you listen, if you listen to new films or TV when they light a cigarette, you can really, it goes, you know, so yeah, it's yeah, now yeah, impossible to tell what the reality is because yeah, the simulacrum has come to dominate that's our right, perception. But what I wanted to ask you, Gregor, first was nicotine, not cigarettes. You do focus on the drug and you do very firmly set out a case for the drug being powerfully psychoactive.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not a popular position, is it? I mean, a lot of the kind of thrust of the anti-smoking drive or the move away in our culture from use of tobacco has been to deny its psychoactive properties, hasn't it? And I wondered mm-hmm, if you could say mm-hmm, something about that, about mm-hmm, your view of it as a psychoactive yeah, and what you think it does as a psychoactive and what you think is involved in this idea that mm-hmm, it's, what if it's not psychoactive, then what is it that they're trying to say that it is, and why are they trying to say that? Huh.
Oh yeah, that's a good question. I think I've always been convinced that it's a chemical thing that's happening in my brain, and it's very material. It's this particular drug that's given me a lot of pleasure and helped me with my creativity. I mean, there's no question that it helps you to, you know, get the juices flowing and things start working. And I've always experienced that as a very positive thing. And the nicotine itself is not so dangerous. It's just it's a stimulant and it does wonderful things to your brain. And so I think the people who've been wanting to sort of vilify it, they focus on the other stuff. The fact that when you smoke, it's not just you enjoying the pleasure, but the whole room is part of it necessarily. And there are all these additives in cigarettes that's a sort of attack that the Germans have taken, listing the hundreds of different additives, chemicals that are that are added to industrial cigarettes, and in fact, there are a couple of brands now that are sort of organic, bio cigaretten, and
they're American Spirit.
Yes, American Spirit, which are they're very good cigarettes. And
I got to tell my American Spirit story at this point because okay, we are here to talk. So when American Spirit were launched, I was writing for the Times, and I was doing a column where I wrote about anything. I'll write about anything. And so they used to send me from the desk at the Times, they'd send me flyers for all sorts of new stuff. This stuff came through about this new cigarette. Naturally, I thought, I know, I'll write a column about cigarettes. I mean, this was like 20 years ago, but already the idea of writing a newspaper column about cigarettes was an anathema.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, I would never promote a product as a cheesy thing to do, but cigarettes, it's like promoting heroin. So I went out to lunch with this guy called Robin Summers, who'd started Natural American Spirit. He's Californian, of course. Looked super fit. He looked like you, Gregor. Boy, super fit. About halfway through lunch, we talked about this and that. I said, "Do you smoke, Robin?" He said, "No, I'm a jogger." He'd started this cigarette company. Mm-hmm. He never smoked at all. And anyway, the lunch went well, I wrote the little column, and every week for 2 years, he sent me a carton of cigarettes of Natural American. If you came round to my house in the late 90s, you didn't get offered a cigarette, not even a pack of cigarettes, you got offered a carton. There was, and it was just this ridiculous cigarette largesse.
Wow, yes.
Of course, I went off them. Anyway, back to the record.
Well, one chapter in my book is about my great aunt Anna, who used to work in a cigarette factory, and she was the employee representative of Brinkmann in Bremen, which is a big company, and she would get even when she was retired, she would get two cartons a month as part of her
retirement
salary, pension. Yeah. And then she died, and they asked me if I wanted to inherit this.
Well, it could be inherited.
Right. Yes, it was inheritable. And I took them for a while, and then, but I didn't like them. They were a lot extra, which is a terrible brand. They're really nasty. And so.
But you didn't think of handing it on to somebody else, or just stockpiling them and selling them.
We were talking about karma earlier, This
you
is
thought
bad,
that would
that's
be bad
karma.
Karma.
That's definitely bad karma. Yeah.
But your point, to get back to the kind of psychoactive effects of nicotine, I think of, in vast quantities, when you think about, Amerindian shaman who are using vast amounts of nicotine, it's a very, very powerful psychotropic drug, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it seems to be that we as a culture have adapted for a certain kind of low-dose regimen, where it's both a kind of central nervous system suppressant because of increasing the levels of carbon dioxide in the bloodstream, and a stimulant, a central nervous stimulant at the same time. And as I was saying in my introduction, it's the kind of purple heart, really. It's phenobarbitone in that way.
Which is perfect for writing, working, because you want the stimulation, but if you overstimulate, then you want to run out and do something else with your life and not sit there and write, and so it's the perfect balance. I think it's actually done great things to sort of contemporary culture or 20th century culture. Actually, I think much of it made from Muzio to Bob Dylan to whoever wouldn't have happened without all those cigarettes. I mean,
it's a strong statement. You the major cultural movements of the 20th century is powered by.
I think so. I really think so. There's this this movie. I forgot the name of the movie about the young Bob Dylan touring in here in England.
England. Yes. D.W. Pennebaker. Back.
And all he does is smoke.
Yeah,
it's
he's
amazing.
He's also doing a hell of a lot of amphetamine.
Yeah,
I mean, you've got to bear in mind, they do go together like a horse and a carriage.
I wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know?
No, I wouldn't know.
You've never taken amphetamine?
No, I never have.
In a way,
not
you've never smoked till you've taken amphetamine. Because, if you're on a really lengthy amphetamine, Jane, I once surfaced from one and realized that I'd smoked 100 cigarettes during the night.
Oh, wow.
In fact, I did stay up around the 100 mark for about 3 or 4 months, and that's the point at which, and I wasn't taking any other drugs at the time, when I really realized how psychotropic nicotine could be. Mm-hmm. But you make an even more powerful statement than that in your essay. You assert, sir, that you never would have become a writer. In a way, nicotine.
Yes.
Defend that position.
Oh.
Because there's this key moment you describe of you kind of becoming self-actualized. It's very interesting in relation to nicotine.
Yes, I was 6 years old at the time. I smoked my first cigarette when I was six. And the way I remember it is that I actually have a very, very, very acute memory of that scene. And the word scene is operative here because all my memories, childhood memories before that, were just images, like photographs, still images, and no voice and nothing. And this scene of my smoking my very first cigarette is like a mini film in my memory. And I put two and two together, and I think what happened is that if something. I became a storyteller that way. It was my very first story. Is the story that I'm actually writing in the book. It's my mother, I think you do this too at New Year's. You light these fireworks, rockets, right? And my mother would give me a cigarette to light the rockets. And I tried, and I was little, and I wasn't, I don't know, I didn't do a very good job at it. And my mother said, well, you have to drag, you smoke, otherwise it the cigarette goes out, and you can't do it. And I started smoking that way, and then the first couple of years, I sort of New Year's would come around, it would be December, and I'd start thinking about the fireworks and all the excitement. And then after 2 years or so, I started thinking about the cigarettes first. And this was the moment I would get another cigarette. And so this very my very first memory of, where actually there's a full a scene developing in my in my mind. And I've always smoked when I wrote, or I've always written when I smoked. And and now I don't smoke anymore, and I write less. And so I do think those two things fit together for me.
I mean, I don't want to drill down into this too much, but I'm fascinated by this idea of the memories prior to the cigarette being like still images, and the memories after the cigarette being, as it were, full motion film.
Yeah.
And you may be aware of research in neuroscience that indicates that perception, visual perception, is a series of still images. You know, what your consciousness does.
I remember you talking about that. Yeah.
So in a way, you know, what the Cartesian thinking eye is that part of the consciousness that is the creator of narrative. So it's almost like you were actualized as a person perceptually by the cigarette.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing when you write about this relationship between cigarettes and writing that I think about is the periodicity of the cigarette. The fact that the cigarette has a determined duration that creates a series of linked episodes. So I think it continually drives the individual to contemplate the relationship, without being too fancy, between the episodic and the diachronic. You know, is experience a continuous and undifferentiated thing, or is it a series of discrete moments?
Yeah.
And the fact of smoking somehow brings that into much sharper focus. Mm. And you can, because it provides you with this little yardstick of time that you're holding up to the undifferentiated world. Right, then it becomes very easy to understand why it's so useful for writing. Yeah. Because what is writing but a series of judgments about when something constitutes an episode or when it needs to elide into something bigger? Mm-hmm. So it's almost like you're, by smoking, you're kind of putting on a kind of writing prosthesis in some way, a kind of psychic prosthesis. Uh-huh. Yeah. Would you agree?
Yeah, I agree.
Good, right, that's all.
Okay, next. I think it's interesting looking at the story that you're telling, what you're writing, especially if you're writing about yourself, the continuity, also the biographical continuity, of course. You know, who am I? I am a smoker. One aspect of that is that I look at all the different stages in my life, and there's one thing that they all have in common: it's the cigarette. And then there's also the structure of the text, which is paragraph by paragraph, and each paragraph takes about 25 minutes to draft, and that's exactly the time you
for the next
cigarette. And I still have that sort of, even though I've quit smoking 5 years ago, I still have that sort of 25 minute rhythm in my thinking, writing. It's still there, and then I do something else. I get up or drink tea or something like
that. But you always seamlessly integrated it with the act of writing. So when you were sitting down to write, you'd have your writing equipment and your paper, whatever however you were writing, and you'd have your cigarette.
Right, yeah. Of course, I struggled like everyone, and there were periods when I didn't smoke, or I smoked cigars, or did other stuff to somehow create that same excitement. But essentially, that's how it was. Yeah.
Tell me a bit, because I think it's interesting for us here in London, a bit about the kind of German smoking culture when you were growing up in the 70s and 80s. Yeah. What was it like? Because it was very different, I think, in some ways to Britain. And I always remember, I think I put it in that introduction I wrote, doing an event at the old literature house at Wannsee outside Berlin with this guy who just smoked blowing smoke in my face. And I'd given up. And afterwards, rather, I wanted to beat his head out on the floor and suck his brain. But rather than do that, I said, look, why? You know, he was overweight, he was tossing back white wine at the same time. I said, I said, frankly, old boy, you're in a hell of a state. You know, why are you carrying on like this? And he said, every morning I get up and I feel dreadful. And I can see, he was brutally honest about it. He said, I am fat. I drink too much, smoke too much. Every morning I get up and I think, maybe I should moderate my habits. And then I remember my grandfather at Stalingrad. And I think of the astonishing deprivation he must have gone through before being killed by the Russians. And then I light a cigarette. But I think he also mentioned...
I know this guy.
Yeah. Do you? You probably do.
I think so, at the LTB, yeah.
I think he was also evoking a particular thing in German culture in relation to the Hitler time, that Hitler was a very anti-smoker.
Right.
And there was a sense in the war that not only had this fucker destroyed the country and led millions of Germans to their deaths, as well as killing a lot of other people, but he'd stopped us smoking, bastard. And when Hitler was gone, everybody lit up. Is that true?
I don't know if that's really true, because, I mean, the cigarettes came into the country after the war from the Americans.
Yeah.
The Americans brought the cigarettes and they distributed the Chesterfields, and a lot of people thought that was a great thing. But Germans were more interested in sausage than in cigarettes. There was this time in the 50s when you know, your sort of wealth or your... Your life, you know, quality of life was basically measured by how many sausages you could get, and so people had these huge dinners. And I remember my grandmother; she was a great cook, and but then she always cooked in a way with the limitation of, you know, not having all that much material to cook with. And when that limitation was gone in the 60s, she started, in 70s, she started cooking. She put too much butter in everything, too much of this, too much of that. And her cooking skills fell apart. It was a big...
Under conditions of abundance.
It was too abundant. She couldn't deal with the lack of limitation there. And so that's what that was. The cigarettes... I don't know. I grew up, you know, I'm not that old, so I didn't grow up right after the war. I smoked my first cigarette around 1970, I went to a boarding school when I was 10 years old, and the boarding school was right on the Dutch border. It was actually part of the school was, the campus was on, in Holland, and this was a time when cigarettes were much, much cheaper in Holland than in Germany, and we had a special route to Holland around the
checkpoint.
Yeah. Yes, and we carried, of course, not only cigarettes, we also carried a lot of hash. And also supplied some other people who weren't involved in the school. They would come. We became dealers, essentially.
And smugglers.
Smugglers and dealers. We just had to go across the tennis courts, and we were right there. We were in Holland, and we smoked these super strong Dutch tobacco, Vanille Zwaar. It was illegal in Germany at the time. They were so strong, they were illegal.
But you had Schwarzerklaus.
Black.
Didn't you?
I did, wait.
Oh, did you bring some?
I forgot, I brought you something. Huh? Here it is.
Thank you very much.
You're most welcome.
Black Cross, thank you so much, Greg.
Yes, you're welcome.
But that's been around forever in Germany.
It's been around for a long time, yeah.
That's as strong as Van.
Yeah, it's a strong, but I don't know. We had this sort of Dutch orientation, and then it sort of transited into sort of a late hippie culture, I would say. So we were rolling our own cigarettes. and they were very thin, just like you said,
whippet
thing, yeah, thin, yeah. You know. And we didn't do that because we wanted to save the tobacco. We just thought it was really cool to have these very thin cigarettes, and we also were very thin. Everything was thin,
proportionate, and
which is I think probably a reaction to the sausage generation, and then we started to mix in this hashish into the tobacco, and that was also sort of a transition. We transitioned into stronger stuff, and really enjoyed feeling miserable.
I suppose what I was more driving at was that, you know, Richard Doll's pioneering report on the epidemiological link between lung cancer and cigarette smoking was published in Britain in, I think, 1957. I could be wrong about that. And I once asked a friend of mine, actually the old gangster John McVicar, who was super fit. He's still with us, though. He's disappeared from view. He went to live in Bulgaria, but not because of the fags over there, though that is a big fag smuggling culture. Anyway, I once said to him, John, this would be 20 years ago, I said, did you ever smoke? He said, oh yeah, I used to smoke a lot. I said, when did you give up? He said, 1958. After I read Richard Doll's report, I gave up the next day. I thought, that's what you get if you're a serious criminal. You just make a decision. You just act. You're like an existentialist. It's like Jean-Paul Belmondo, if you read Richard Doll's report. You go, like that, over. Yeah. Move forward, do the job, give up smoking. And when I was growing up in the 60s, you know, my first cigarette was a bone dry senior service taken from my grandparents' silver presentation cigarette box. I would have been about 10 or 11. And there was an indulgent attitude towards it from the adults. And, I mean, we did sneak around a bit, but basically they knew. And there was a sense of a huge smoking culture. Because still at that point, say around 1970, probably between 60 and 70% of the British adult population smoked.
Yeah.
At the same time as this nascent awareness that it was killing everybody stone dead. Mm-hmm. So this kind of weird, you know, really kind of essentially schizoid attitude towards tobacco was one that I grew up with. It was never, you know, apropos of which, you know, I was talking, my wife introduced me to the vaping. And there's been all this thing about, is vaping bad for you, is it not bad for you? And I think my wife made the exactly the right point. She said, it's not a question of whether it's good or bad for you. The great delight of vaping is we don't know. Mm-hmm. So we're like our parents now when they were smoking. Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of interesting. And I never knew that era of as it were, innocent smoking.
Yeah.
And I wonder whether you ever did.
I think I did, yeah. Yeah. I think I was totally innocent of it. I mean, I was completely isolated in this boarding school, and there were two danger issues attached with smoking. One coming from my father, who was a fire expert. And it was all about you can't drop a cigarette, you know, how the house is going to burn down.
And you had these fire extinguishers in every room.
In every room, there were fire extinguishers, and it was crazy. So it was all about that from my father's side. And from the school's side, it was a sin.
Yeah.
It was a religious sin. So there were certain things you were not supposed to do. One of them was smoking. And the health issue didn't even occur to me. I mean, when I was 16, 17, I didn't care whether, you know, I thought I would be old when I'm 35 and I would die. And it doesn't
so what,
you know, one more year, 10 more years, it doesn't matter. I just smoked.
And was there any consistent public health campaigning at that point? You know, because again, I was very conscious, because I'm such a nicotine head from the get-go, of the banning of cigarette advertising on British TV, but the persistence of cigar advertising. Mm. You know, the Hamlet adverts going on for another 10 years, the removal then of tobacco advertising. I remember going to the West Indies, and I would have been about 14 or 15. My uncle lived in the West Indies, And there was an advert. I'm going to have to give you this in full. I'm sorry. There was an advert on Radio Antilles that went like this. Daddy, why do you smoke State Express 555s? I smoke them, son, because they're the taste of success. Daddy, when I grow up, I'm going to smoke State Express 555s. You do that, son. Yeah. Incredibly shocking, yeah. Even in the mid-70s. Mm. What is this weird culture? Yeah. But you have.
But they're still. I mean, if you watched a.
That's the Surgeon General on the phone. He's heard about this.
If you've watched Mad Men, you know it starts in this age of innocence and then slowly moves on into this. You know, the first sort of health warnings come about and so on.
Draper's big thing is to. Take the full page ad in the New York Times about the dangers of smoking. Do you remember?
Yeah. And then it's toasted.
It's toasted.
So, but none of that occurred to me. But it might just have been me. I was very innocent of it. So I could concentrate on the positive aspects and enjoy those cigarettes that I did smoke until then. You know, it went so far, you know, that I would own, you know, my breakfast would consist of, you know, 3 cups of German bitter coffee and 5 cigarettes, and then I would go outside and puke. Yeah. And then I noticed it was personal experience. It wasn't advertising. It wasn't somebody else telling me this is bad for you. I just noticed this is really bad.
You were like ill.
I was ill, physically ill. Yes.
You've always been quite sporty as well. So
yes,
you must have noticed a lag in that.
Absolutely, I've always had the urge to be sporty, and then I had these phases of smoking, and I had phases of endurance sport, and I noticed that the two didn't go together so well. I also had some asthma issues as a child, and all of that. I put 2 and 2 together. I'm not a health advocate, and the book is not about, you know, whether you should smoke or not smoke. I really don't care what people do, and really, it's more about how we you know confront our own issues, what we do, how do we, you know, when we sit there, all of a sudden, I've made a decision, I say, okay, this is a big part of my, has been a big part of my life, and now it isn't anymore. What happens in that moment? What are the things that I think about? How do I make a narrative to explain things in a biographical way? Do I draw on research? Do I work through images in my mind? Mm. And there are some pictures in the book that are really sort of quirky sort of images, because I attach certain images to those experiences. And so it's really like a tiny moment of thought about this issue that I'm blowing up to 170 pages, and I'm looking at every minute detail of every thought I have about this, and that's why then the book became sort of something between a memoir and an essay and sort of a research summary and some pictures and everything, because I think there's no one genre to that you can sort of used to capture that entire moment.
Yeah, but I mean, it's very existential, your involvement with nicotine and tobacco, and it's all about, you know, does it actualize yourself, and does the renunciation of it determine the creation of a new identity and a new sense of personhood?
Right.
And though you draw into the text a lot of social and cultural detail, it's not really about that, is
right.
it? I mean, you just said it. You don't care, in a way, about public health policy or about... Whereas, I have to say that as you say, a committed smoker, though I haven't been smoking much recently for obvious reasons, that I've always been acutely aware of the social context of smoking and of nicotine use. It's always struck me. And I think that the nicotine is very interesting as a drug because it is the only drug our culture has ever used that is a drug of addiction, of physical dependency, where it seems to fly in the face of the contemporary thinking on the nature of addiction. So the nature of addiction, if you come up through the 12-step programs like Alcoholics Anonymous, Alcoholics Anonymous, the view of addiction is that addiction inheres not in the substance, but in the individual. You have an addictive personality. Well, if that's the case, then when I began smoking, 70% of the population, adult population of Britain, were drug addicts, innately, not as a function of it. Now, that can't really be true, can it? You know, nor does nicotine use imply in the moment. You know, you don't, you know, again, an AA definition for the nature of alcoholism or addiction is you can never know what's going to happen when you take the intoxicant. You know, one day you have a sherry with the vicar, and then you have another sherry with the vicar, and one day you have a sherry with the vicar. 12 hours later, you're lying under Charing Cross Bridge without any trousers on, kind of singing Auld Lang Syne, even though it's midsummer. You know, and that doesn't really obtain with nicotine, does it? So there's something kind of, it seems to be something. And what it suggests to me is if you look more to anthropology for an understanding of the use of intoxicants, you find things like the idea that you, really Leary was onto this with set and setting in relation to LSD and hallucinogens in the 60s, that there's a kind of quadratic relationship with psychoactive drugs in cultures. There's what we think it's doing, you know, what it may be doing in a pure and, as it were, metabolic or physiological sense, and what our individual perception is of it, and how it's acculturated. All of these factors are in play, and the effect is a function of that. And it's fascinating with nicotine, how, and you can see this clearly with nicotine, and then you map it back onto other drugs, how society adapts their use to make them productive, in a way, to make them work for the, you know, and it seems to me, it's not an original observation, the cigarette in particular, both produced by industrial methods and fueling particularly manufacturing industry. Again, you know, we look upon it as writers, as this great kind of, you know, habit and drug of writing. But in a way, the 20th century's drive for mechanization was fueled by nicotine addiction
Well.
Sorry, I didn't mean to deliver that short lecture, but it does.
It's wonderful. I mean, you. I don't have the you know, the broad comparative view on drugs. So maybe that's why I make such a to-do about nicotine, because I can't compare it to anything else.
Well,
maybe I'm writing about addiction per se, because that's the only addiction that I know.
I just want to ask you one more thing before we throw it open. This is not said in any kind of weird way, but many people, when you gave up 4 or 5 years ago, many people would like want to turn their back on it completely. I mean, I know you wrote the essay as you were, you know, giving up as an exercise.
Right.
But thereafter, you know, when we've known each other a while now, and we often talk about
We
often talk about nicotine and smoking.
We do, yeah.
You're still really engaged by it, and you're really a one day at a time man. I mean, I feel that your hand is twitching. Towards the browser as we speak. Is that true?
Yeah,
still?
But it's a productive tension.
It's a productive tension.
Yeah, definitely. But so
you like to maintain that tension. It's almost like a magnet. Yeah,
maybe it's there. I don't know if I need to produce it to make it, but it's okay. But I remember when I was still smoking, and I was, of course, I tried many times to quit, and sometimes it worked for a few weeks, for a few months, and so on. And so I have a memory of what I felt when I thought about quitting. And I always thought, I don't want to become one of those assholes who demonizes the whole thing. I don't want to be the guy who complains about other people smoking and so on. I really don't. And I really think it's wonderful that there are people who smoke. And I like to smell it every once in a while. And I sometimes I envy the people who who stand outside of the bars, and they actually seem to be having a much better time than the people inside. Yeah, it's so true. Yeah, it's and you get,
you've got issues, man. I see those people hanging around outside bars, and I think, God, that is just utterly miserable. There is no.
But it depends. Sometimes it's miserable. I mean, it's like February in New York. It's miserable. But there's so many people. I mean, in Germany, the bars have put out these heat lamps, and people gather around, and they get to know each other immediately because they ask for a light and so on. And it's nice. I sometimes wish I were a part of that.
Yeah, they are fascinating. Those kind of bodged up pseudo rooms for smoking, yeah, with a kind of space heater in them.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like a kind of provisional architecture that reflects the provisionality of the cigarette itself. It's kind of a pop-up world. I first saw them in Dublin when they'd introduced the band there, and I thought, this is...
I even created a word for them, fumotope, in German, fumotope.
From smoke place.
Fumare and topos, yeah. Fumotope.
Well done.
Thank you.
I don't know if
it translates well, but...
Opening a dictionary and seeing that with your etymology.
Yeah, one of these days.
Okay, well, listen, should we throw things open? Anybody have any comments, questions, anything they'd like to say? There's a microphone. The gentleman in the front row here who looks like he's had a pipe or two.
Has anybody here heard of a guy called Paul Sadler?
Paul Sadler?
Sadler.
S-A-D-L-E-R. No.
Nobody?
No.
He's a sort of Alex... Is it Alex Campbell, the spin doctor?
Oh, Alistair Campbell.
Alistair Campbell. He's the spin doctor of the tobacco industry.
Oh, so is he with that outfit, Forrest?
No, he's on big money with Imperial Tobacco.
Oh, he's actually in the pay.
Really big, big time.
Okay.
Go on Google and just put in that name and Imperial Tobacco. Or even if you put in Philip Morris or British American Tobacco.
You'll get him.
Yeah.
And what do you want to tell us about this fellow?
Are you this person?
Yes, that's me.
I knew.
Do you want to borrow a fiver? Yeah. Anyway, I was listening, the way I got hold of this guy, around about 2000, I was listening to Talk Sport or Talk Radio, whatever it was. And it was run by a New Zealand guy. 6'3", 6'4". I could never remember this guy's name, but Paul Sandler came on this show. I never heard of him. And amongst all the things he was saying, they were discussing tobacco and all the aspects of it. It was in the news, cancer and everything else. And he said quite straightforward, well, it's yet to be proved that nicotine is addictive.
Okay. Interesting point. Modern. Well, thank you for that.
Hi, can you describe your the most intense experiences you've had from nicotine? And do you know if anyone uses it for journeying like you would use ayahuasca or any other kind of drugs?
Well, I mean, certainly shamans in South America have always used tobacco for exactly that, to create out-of-body experiences. I think it's not... Weirdly, to answer your question, I gave up smoking in 2000. It's the only year of my life, the year of no nicotine. And it was okay. I wrote quite a lot of it in Germany, actually, on trains. And that's when the incident occurred with the guy in the literature house at the Bonsi. And one of the reasons I gave up smoking, apart from all the obvious ones, was because I found myself standing in front of Dunhill's in, German Street, and staring at the pipes. And I felt this strange draw towards pipe smoking, and I thought, I can't go there. That's just unacceptable. I don't know if anybody knows David Shrigley, the artist. He did a little drawing. Actually, it's just an outline of a man with a pipe, and the caption is, "All pipe smokers are cunts." And I think that was in the back of my mind at that point. And I thought, you cannot go that route. So I gave up. And of course, when I relapsed a year later, I picked up the pipe. And I realized that all of these old geezers I'd seen all my life, sort of drowsing by allotment sheds, were monged out of their brains on nicotine. Mm. Absolutely high as kites. And if you've never smoked a properly loaded pipe of Squadron Leader or one of the really beefy, high nicotine content shags. I mean, it's amazing that there isn't more of a literature of psychedelic voyaging kind of coming out of people like J.B. Priestley. And he must have kept that kind of stuff to himself. So that was one mega experience. And the other mega nicotine experience is, of course, this thing, which is the most efficient nicotine delivery system ever devised by a human being. It's just an incredible, developed in the Pearl River Delta in the Foxconn factories by nameless laborers and technologists in that, you know, kind of Chinese latifundium. Nobody knows who invented it. It's a computer peripheral. And it just gets you hopelessly stoned. And I know that people realize this at an ulterior level, because what's the argument against vaping? It's been banned lickety-spick. And there's no reason for it. There's no secondary smoke.
It's been banned where?
London transport, restaurants. Yeah. Huh. Anywhere you start vaping, some little fucking Jobsworth pops up out of nowhere and says, smoking's not allowed. And you say, I'm not smoking, I'm vaping. It's steam.
Smoking's not allowed. It's an electronic cigarette.
And my reasoning on this is, in fact, the culture has moved on insidiously so much that people who don't smoke and either have given up or never did, when they see the grim revenant standing outside Witherspoon's dying, they don't mind them smoking because they think, ha, you're dying, you tosser. But when they see me looking all spelt with my vaporizer, it's like I'm having a little wank in public. They cannot fucking bear the idea I'm getting this little kick and it's not even killing me. It's like this was invented as a kind of litmus test of the ulterior Puritanism and Calvinism of English culture, and it's alive and kicking. Sorry.
But to see you using that doesn't have quite the same aesthetic qualities as, say, Marlon Dietrich or somebody, you know, in a...
Well, that's because I'm not Marlene Dietrich, isn't it? It's pretty bloody obvious. I'm a rather kind of ugly man in his mid-50s. I'm not fucking Marlene Dietrich.
It's not accentuated or exaggerated the physical and pharmacological aspects of nicotine, rather than looking at it more in a socio and cultural sense, and the way in which people's whole identity is tied up with being a smoker. And you can't imagine yourself, irrespective of, you know, being able to go and buy an electronic cigarette or whatever it is, you can't imagine yourself existing in the world without a total social and cultural transformation of yourself.
Are you talking about yourself?
Yes, I'm definitely talking about myself, but also about the inadequacies of health promotion campaigns, which always concentrate on the physical and the negative sides of smoking, and not on all the positive, fantastic sides of smoking in terms of how you relax and relate socially to other people, etc.
But I'm interested in your image. I mean, and we didn't, I agree, we didn't talk, as it were, about the kind of film noir of smoking, about the filmic aspect, and about the idea that whenever you light a cigarette, you're almost automatically placed vis-a-vis with yourself. You know, it's like having a new hat every time. You can clock yourself in the mirror. Oh, there I am with a cigarette. And that maybe is something to do with the quality of smoke itself, to veil to, you know, as it were, to transform the ineluctable modality of the visible in all of those ways. It's why cigarette smoking interlinks with film. And also, you're right, the kind of stylization, the angle you hold it at, cigarette holders, the kit in that way. You can look at whole fashions as well as cinematographic techniques that clearly evolved in relation to cigarette use. But I'm surprised at you, who are clearly a grown-up, still being enthralled to all of that, are you?
Hmm? I've tried to give up smoking a lot of times, and I can't even get through one morning.
Really?
And certainly in social situations, even in the rare periods where I've given up, you know, for maybe a couple of weeks or whatever, there's no way I could survive as feeling myself without a cigarette. And I love people who smoke.
Well, that's, you know, when Gregor has a bit about, both of us were preoccupied by trying to find the source of this famous line, I've given up smoking than any man alive. Every time I stub one out, I swear it's my last, which lots of people attribute to Mark Twain, but I thought it was in Ippolito Svevo's Confessions of Zeno.
We haven't found it in either
one.
No.
Yeah. But the quote that we both like in Svevo, which seems to relate to you, and I can't do it verbatim, is, Perhaps the reason I never managed to give up smoking was because my idea was that if I did give up smoking, I would be a better man and would realize all of these kind of moral and perhaps even kind of artistic attributes that were repressed. So by not giving up, I'm not threatening I'm not admitting to myself that I've just failed to become a good person. You see what I'm saying?
Well, I just think the person who was talking and giving, I thought he would be a much more interesting and better person if he was smoking.
Oh, Gregor. Oh, that's really,
so?
That's really harsh.
Yeah.
So you think he should die for his art? Right? Anybody else?
On the vaping, I think we just need to give it some more time. You know, there's no cultural production around.
Yeah.
Around vaping, and but you could give it 100 years, which is about the time that smoking had to become sort of culturally wrought and freighted, and wait for Apple to design the first vapor, and then it will enter the culture and iconography that way. Why not? I'm not sure. I understood what you were just saying. You think so? You think I should start smoking again to become
more creative?
I'm not creative enough, huh? Yeah.
Okay.
No, I prefer to be. I prefer to be this boring old self that I am now, and you just have to live with it.
Anybody else? The Gummeister.
Hi, Gregor. Nice to see you. Hello. And Will, hello. I was a smoker up to 3 years ago, and I stopped, but I went straight on to nicotine substitutes. I don't like patches, but I've used Nicorette. I've used Nicassist from Boots. And also, Sainsbury's do a really good 4 milligram lozenge as well for £7 a time. I've noticed recently that Nicorettes are now doing a maximum dosage of 6 milligrams. That's what you said last time I mentioned it. I'll buy you some. But what interests me is two or three times since I stopped smoking, and during a period about 10 years ago when I stopped smoking but went on the Nicorette, was I've had periods of complete abstinence from nicotine, and I go absolutely mad.
Yeah, you do.
I've spoken to Will about this before. I've looked for the symptoms on the internet, and they say you get irritable or you might feel strange for a day or two. I end up feeling like I'm in a Jimi Hendrix LP. I start hallucinating almost like I'm on LSD. I start thinking of the possibility, if not actually experiencing, telepathic communication with aliens. it's great for a while. I feel this kind of tantric energy flowing around my body from these kind of psychic centres somewhere inside myself. But what I've written very well on under that condition as well. Some hallucinatory passages from books I've written were written in that state. But what happens is it starts to diminish and close down after a few weeks. Mm-hmm. The experience becomes so intense that I can't operate any longer. And I find everything enormously difficult to do. I have no idea what this experience is about. Mm. I feel massively special that I have it because no one else talks about it. But I wondered if you had any view on this, or whether anyone else here has ever had that experience.
Thank you for sharing. I mean, I'm hoping for some powerful identification. Gregor, I mean, you are quite tripped out when you give up.
It only took a couple of days for me. I was in a very interesting, very excited state for a few days. But I remember I abstain from food for a while, for a few days, fasting, sort of as a medical fasting kind of thing. And I don't know what happened to me in this period. It was amazing, and during this period I had to direct a dissertation defense, and the poor candidate had to live with me. I was all over the place. So it was the, you know, I think it's not the particular nicotine withdrawal. It's just putting your body through something and your mind through something so radical, and it doesn't matter whether you give up smoking or you give up food for a while. It just turns you upside down, and it's a very intense experience.
I must say, I've always found what I've noticed. The most obtrusive feature of nicotine withdrawal is a kind of emotional lability, a sort of sense that you may cry or be enraged or be at any second and very, very, very mercurial, very changeable, and really enjoying that and sort of thinking, that, because I think of the culture we're in, where this idea that, you know, if you're in touch with your feelings, you must be like a really healthy person emotionally. So I think when I was withdrawing from nicotine, I think, oh God, finally I'm emotionally healthy. I feel like crying over an Andrex commercial and beating the shit out of my children simultaneously. How healthy can you get? Anybody identify with Nick's experience of feeling like he's in a Jimi Hendrix album? No. You're right. You're
special.
You're special. We knew
it's
that.
Good news,
gentleman
yes.
there in a very nice white shirt.
Oh, thank you. I can't say that I identify with it, but it was certainly a line that was very popular in the 50s with the tobacco industry, that that stopping smoking was associated with a sort of rage and psychosis.
You're not that old, are you?
Actual psychosis.
Yes, I mean the idea was that there are many reasons why you shouldn't stop smoking because it was cool and good for you, but. The idea that that it was, you know, there were particular personality types and that you should, you know, be wary of quitting because of the problems. And of course, it's interesting because it's come back again, and the complications that are, or the anxiety about using varenicline as a medication to stop smoking.
What's the medication?
Well, it's a medication called varenicline or Champix or Chantix. Chantix in the US.
I've seen people go bonkers on that Champix stuff.
But the interesting thing, of course, is that we've been talking about the things that happen when people withdraw from nicotine, and, you know, including some quite extreme reactions. But of course, that's also something that happens if you take a medication that causes you to...
Man, that's fascinating about that Champix stuff, because it's an SSRI, isn't it? It's a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, like Suroxat or Prozac, which are all bullshit anyway.
No, it's not.
It's not. Champix isn't.
No. Is it?
You're a doctor, aren't you?
Yeah, I
can you have the microphone back? I want more out of it. You don't specialise in respiratory disease.
Yeah, no, I do have some interest in emphysema. So I've spoken to thousands of people who start smoking and heard thousands of people explain why they're not going to stop just yet. So I'm particularly grateful for your anecdote about carrying on smoking because my grandfather died in Stalingrad, which is, I almost laughed out loud when I read that in the Guardian the other week. I don't think anyone's going to top that in the rest of my career.
But what's your overall? Can you perhaps? I'm trying to get the group therapy aspect going here. Can you perhaps address the woman back there? And what did you think of what she said? You know, because she said that public health campaigns that focus on health issues and negatives don't work. So would you rather what positives could they concentrate on?
I think that there ought to be a realistic assessment of the pleasures of smoking.
The benefits. What do you think of that,
Carl? We all know about the negative aspects and the physiological and
What about this thing that there was some research and some suggestions recently that nicotine is an antidepressant? Did you buy any of that at all, Doc?
No.
Not at all.
So I mean, I think the interesting thing about this is that you're talking about it as your experience and as something to do with your agency and actualization. But essentially, smoking is something that we do to children. It's something that we inflict on children, and it's something that we should all be a little bit ashamed of as a society, because we've known for 60 years what smoking does.
Right.
Generations of children have grown up, and there are all kinds of societal reasons why that is, why people in positions of power have refused to act on it. So when the UK Department of Health first acknowledged that that smoking caused cancer, their response to the Dole report, the Minister of Health appeared on television smoking.
Yeah, but hang on a minute,
Doc. It's funny, but
hang on a minute, Doc. Would you not argue that some of the inroads that drugs make to societies are because there's a maladaption, there's no vertical transmission, which is what you're drawing our attention to, that's a constructive ritual of intoxication? Presumably you like a drink in moderation.
So the idea
hang on a minute, just answer the question.
I'm going to answer your first question. The idea that this is the case, you've sort of addressed it yourself already. So adult male smoking rates just after war were about 90%.
Yeah.
And now they're about 20%.
Yeah.
So what is the change in creativity or in our ability to relate to one another as human beings?
Clearly the world's gone to shit since everybody gave up smoking. You've actually drawn the dots of this frightening picture. No Syrian crisis. Think of all that lovely tobacco in Latakia province. There's not enough concentration on that in the whole Middle Eastern crisis.
I think there was a lot going on in the Middle East in 1945 as well. So.
I think we're...
I
want to interject. I think we're, of course, most of us who smoke or have smoked are both victims and perpetrators of this generational transmission. So I think that's important to keep in mind, and I don't think shame is really
called for. Yeah, take your shaming elsewhere. Save it for your clinic.
There's been a lot of shame attached to this already, and I mean we talk about it and we raise consciousness, and everybody I think by now knows what they're doing. Also doing two children, two other people around, and so on, and that's why things are changing, and that's a good thing, and I don't think we need more shame.
Yeah.
On the positive aspects, let me say that too. The positive aspects of smoking, I think we've seen plenty of that. Hollywood movies are full of really satisfying post-coital cigarettes and whatnot. And that's a great thing.
Arguably, there'd have been no coitus without cigarettes.
That's right, for a while. And so I think we've also seen enough of that. I don't think we need to say like, oh, it's only bad news, and where's the good news, and so on. I think we've talked about smoking, as a culture for a long time, and it's all out there. And now we can make a decision. And everyone has to make their own decision, and you can't go around telling other people what to do. Of course, there are limits. Now they're thinking in Germany, they're thinking about prohibiting smoking in cars when children are in cars.
No, they brought that in here.
It's
were probably one of the main architects probably of this draconian legislation. He was, wasn't he?
I think it's a great thing.
You are the shame meister. You probably even designed those posters of the child sort of suffocating in the fag smoke in the car.
So we don't need shame for that. It's a, we need information. We need information.
What?
But you're talking about people making choices with
it. I'd always crack a window if I was actually smoking a cigar.
I don't know this person.
But you know, hundreds of thousands of children are breathing in tobacco smoke in cars. Yeah. So what, are they making a choice?
It's a terrible thing, and I'm glad that this legislation is coming about. But we don't need to shame people to do get on that side of the issue.
I think that's your point as well, really, at root, isn't it? You don't want to be shamed, and in fact, if he spoke to you less in that shamey voice that he's got at the moment, he'd probably give up tomorrow. There's a woman at the back who has something to say.
I just wanted to say that they have actually proved...
You have to hold it in the region of your mouth.
They have... Hello?
Like a cigarette.
Yeah.
They have actually proved that it stops you getting Alzheimer's, haven't they?
Nope.
What was that?
The woman in the back said they've proved it doesn't... stops you getting Alzheimer's.
Oh, yeah.
The doc said, nope.
Only because you die of something else first.
Yes, that's right. But I mean, Doc, you know, when we began smoking, there weren't very many of us, and now there's nearly 9 billion of us. I mean, you know.
I surrendered.
Oh, no, somebody.
Yeah, I think this lady here's got a very good point in that we shouldn't be shaming people. We all know it's killing us, costing us a fortune, all the bad side. So let's focus on what it does do for you. And, I'm quite interested in your idea, Will, that it has some amazing sort of psychotropic or psychoactive qualities, because I never found that. Lots of other drugs, I would agree with you, but not nicotine. And there's no language to accommodate this. If you take coke, you're coked up. You take heroin, you're smacked out. Yeah. You take acid, you're tripping. You're not really nicotined out, man, are you?
And like, I just said I was monged out of my head on nicotine. I think that.
Well, you said stoned.
Oh, did I?
Yeah, and you said that these shamans use it in a psychotropic way. I don't think that's helpful. I also don't think it's accurate.
Really?
I mean, what? Tell me what marvelous psychoactive, psychotropic experiences you've had purely from nicotine.
Well, that's right. I mean, I think that the psych. I think like a lot of in forms of intoxication, if you are a philosophically minded person. They enact what phenomenologists call the epoché. They bracket your entire conscious experience and decouple it from what we might call naive psychological realism. Basically, you stop believing. You start to understand intuitively that the bottle of Badoit you're holding is not perceived the same way by everybody in the room. You get the subjectivity of experience. I think that's a key. I think that's what feeds into Gregor's very existentialist view. Of the actual psychoactive effects of nicotine. So I would counter your point and say we've made a strong case for the psychoactive attributes of nicotine this evening. And what do you have to say to that, Doc? What about the psychoactive elements? Yeah, I mean, I return to the question you refused to answer before. You like a drink?
So,
no, you won't restore an answer it.
Well, but it's not a question about nicotine, is it? People are addicted to nicotine, clearly.
Such casuistry.
They experience withdrawal symptoms.
Yeah.
The relief of those withdrawal symptoms is experienced as a player.
That's the sort of Alan Carr stroke Schopenhauer line. You know, Schopenhauer said there is no such thing as pleasure, there's only the relief from pain. You gloomy old dog. I'm not going to consult you.
You're taking the argument beyond where I...
No, you clearly stated it. That's where that thinking comes from.
I think acknowledging that people smoke because they're addicted to nicotine and to relieve cravings and withdrawal symptoms doesn't mean you have to deny the existence of pleasure.
Right, but you completely deny the idea that we're asserting that we get any pleasure out of it except the relief of our withdrawal.
No, not necessarily. And there's some interesting... questions about, you know, the economic modelling, you know, what value you put on the pleasure of smoking when you're working out the
look, balancing. Listen, everybody in this room who's ever smoked the first cigarette has their head has spun, they vomited, they felt incredibly stoned, and then they've done it again.
which even that isn't quite correct. Mm-hmm. It's different for different people. And actually, the things, you know, when you're interested in emphysema, you think, well, why do some people get emphysema and some people don't? Well, actually, it's to do with smoking, which we know. But it's actually to do with nicotine receptors. So for some people, the first cigarette is an epiphany, and it's just magnificent. They find it harder to quit. They smoke more, and they obviously naturally get more problems from smoking. Other people have to learn to smoke the same way that you have to learn to drink beer, because it's, you know, bitter and not very nice to start with.
Did you ever learn to drink beer?
It's not about me, yes.
Okay, so why can't smoking have a positive form of social acculturation? Because you would agree, even as an emphysema doctor, that low use of tobacco probably isn't that damaging. Or other forms of nicotine.
I wouldn't agree with that, unfortunately. There isn't a safe exposure to tobacco smoke.
Is there a safe exposure to all sorts of things in our environment, though?
Well, I mean...
Do you want to live in a kind of lead-lined room in the bottom of a major London teaching hospital, attended by a 24-hour crash team? Yes, clearly.
People want to live a life which is long enough, which is associated with the ability to get around, to breathe, to do stuff, look after the grandchildren, and not to be dead and disabled 10, 20 years before they would otherwise be.
Okay.
That's the gamble. It's not, you know, being snuffed out.
Yeah. No, I take your point. I mean, you have won. Let's face it. If it was a contest.
Well, again, talking about winning. I mean, there's a process. So the more stuff that countries do around tobacco control, the fewer people smoke.
Yeah.
So
that's no surprise, though.
No, but it isn't a surprise. But when people say, well, we all know that smoking's bad for you, it's actually, you know, you have to work at that, and there are campaigns. And I take the point about shaming. I mean, it's not the only approach to it. There are a whole series of different measurements. But you have to address this properly and help people. You know, there's no point shaming people that often have to quit. But you say we all know about it. Most people in Pakistan who start smoking are starting smoking before the age of 10. Mm. So what's that to do with knowledge, to do with adults, agency?
Before you go, could I just ask you about vaping? What's your take on that, since you are an actual bona fide lung doctor?
Can I add also Champix?
You want to ask him about Champix?
Oh, yeah.
Could you, two then, vaping and Champix.
So it's like all medications, Champix has side effects. I think probably from what we mentioned before, this issue of tobacco withdrawal, which is difficult and can cause, you know, reactions in people sometimes, is somewhat muddled up with Champix. But you know, broadly speaking, it seems to be a safe and effective way to quit smoking.
Okay.
Vaping. Vaping. So the consensus is that vaping is about 5% as bad for you as smoking.
Whoopee!
So the Public Health England will come out with that report, and it's, you know, that's a group of experts in the room having a think about how dangerous it's like to be based on the stuff that comes out of it.
Mm.
It could be 1%, it could be 8%. But ballpark. So for anyone who's smoking, if you switch across to vaping, that's in terms of your likely good health in the future and survival, that's a fantastic improvement.
So will you be lobbying London Transport to allow us to vape on public transport?
I won't, because...
How did I know that that's what you were going to say? It's like I'm psychic. It could be the nicotine.
There may well be a few people who are mean-spirited and just want to deny you pleasure. But the reason that the smoking ban, bans on smoking in bars and other places works, is because it's helping people quit.
Yeah.
So there's the very immediate effect, for example, of people who work in bars, so very immediately their health improves. So there's occupational health, public health issue. Yeah. But it helps encourage people.
That's all a no-brainer. You're not answering the question. We're not talking about that.
So the concern that public health broadly speaking have around vaping is that people will cut down smoking but not quit completely, and even smoking a little bit is extremely bad for you, so not because of nicotine but because of the tar. So if there's a situation where people smoke normally and they just continue to vape in situations where they're not quite allowed to smoke, then they discourage them from quitting. Now, it's interesting. I think this is a question that sort of needs to be answered. Now, I believe that will be that allowing people to vape in situations where they would not be allowed to smoke will make people smoke more. Now, other people believe that if you can vape in those situations, you'll vape all the time and stop smoking. Now, I don't know the answer to that, and it's something actually.
I think you've got a point. You've got a point.
So it's, you know, it's a point. Definitely got a point.
Put him in the chair, wouldn't you, man?
Yeah, the just to stop him jogging. the additives are things, you know, so you're, people who smoke, their heads are being messed with, so there's ammonia added to the cigarettes to make them, essentially to make free-base nicotine. So it's...
Wow, just like free-base and cocaine. Yeah,
so you get So you get a much more rapid hit from that. And then the cool taste of Marlboro. It's cool because they've added as much ammonia as they can. But of course, you don't want to smoke bleach. So you add as much ammonia as you can.
I don't know, I've sniffed enough.
What am I going to do next? So then you add some menthol, so you soothe. So it's chemistry. It's not
evil bastards.
What about those of us who smoke roll-ups? And I'm with the guy around the corner.
Nick.
Addicted to
Nicorette.
I mean, that is.
Yeah, you're addicted to Nicorette, aren't you? Yeah.
But I also have the odd roller, which I regard as being much superior to these dirty, smelly, you know.
The doctor's telling you, Ruth. He told you quite explicitly that you're bullshitting yourself. Shut the fuck up.
I mean, probably roll up.
Is there anything wrong with?
Oh, really?
Worse.
Stick to roll-ups.
All right, that's enough of this. All right, stop it, a lot of you. You've started talking amongst yourselves. You can do that any time. Please thank Gregor Hens. It's an amazing essay. For a signed copy. Buy it. It's really good. Shut up. When were you last at a literary event that was this convivial? Doc.
Thanks, Will.